All right, so we'll start here with this pipe display. This pipe display actually came with the Holtkamp organ that's in McAllister Auditorium. This display indicates, shows different types of pipes that you'll find in the organ, this organ or others. The first one here, this is a principal pipe, and it's very much what you would think an organ pipe would look like. It's, you know, sort of a cylindrical straight metal thing. The parts of an organ pipe are named similarly to parts of the human body. The pipe has a toe, and it has a foot, and it has a mouth, and then it has ears on the side, actually, of the mouth, which seems to be the wrong place. But, and then this is considered the body of the pipe. And so they, you know, that's easy to remember it that way. The pipes are made out of a lead tin alloy. This one's called spotted metal. And this is a principal pipe, or a diapason pipe, which is kind of the primary organ tone. Other metal pipes here, we have some flute pipes. This is a stopped flute, so it in some ways is similar to this pipe, except for it has a cap on the top, right? And this cap actually comes off and it moves, and that's how you tune it. And because it has a cap, it plays a pitch that as if it were twice as long, and the pitch is an octave lower. And this is actually what's called a quintadina. It has a very prominent fifth overtone in it. But if you go to Misha, I always usually show this too, that if you take the top off and blow it, you see the huge difference in the pitch. So that's what but the cap also changes, again, the sound, the overtones that are present in the pipe. This is another metal flute. This is a roar flute, and roar has to do with this little tube or reed on the top, which is actually open. And so this is a partially stopped pipe, whereas this one has a completely stopped top. This one has the reed on the top. Different sound, and the shape of the pipe and the shape of the cap and all affects the sound of it. This is a wooden flute, or a gedecht, and it is also has a stopper in the top, but instead of being a metal cap, it's actually a wooden plunger with a leather gasket on it, and the pipe is made out of, you know, fairly thin pine, just out of wood, and it also has, you know, the same, it has actually a metal toe and a wooden foot, but then it still has the same mouth parts. This is actually called a block in the wooden pipe, but it also, again, I can show you the sort of fluty sound. If you pull the stopper out, you'll see once again that it would play quite a bit higher pitch without the stopper. But, again, the stopper, you know, makes it play the lower pitch but be a shorter pipe. So those are the flute and the principal. The third family of organ tone is a string pipe, and there's only one little string pipe on this. But it's basically, it looks basically the same as the principal pipe, except for, you know, huge difference in size. But they're metal, they're cylindrical. The differences with a string pipe, even though these are quite different pitches, quite different pipes, the strings are always going to be a smaller diameter for their length. So they're very slender. And the strings also have, oftentimes, as this one does, you'll see if you look closely, has what we call an expression slot. So whereas this pipe is simply a cylinder all the way to the top with this sleeve around it, this one actually has an over length to it with a little slot, an expression there, and it adds to the stringy character of the stop. And we'll show some. I'll show these stops on the Fisk organ. And then the fourth family, so we have principals, and then three examples of a flute, and this is actually a flute also, and then the string pipe, and then this is a reed pipe here. And on an organ, the reed stops are actually named generally after the brass and woodwind instruments of the orchestra, like oboe, trumpet, trombone, horn, sort of thing. Reed pipe, again, it's made out of metal, and it has some different parts to it that are not the same as the flute pipe. It has, this is called a boot, actually, on a reed pipe, and it's kind of like the foot of the flute pipe. It serves the same purpose. It holds the thing up. And then we have a resonator, very much like the resonator of a brass instrument. And then inside, these have moving parts, and that's kind of the real difference. It's very much like the mouthpiece of a clarinet or a saxophone inside. There is I didn't bring any tools in with me. Pop this apart, but probably not. But anyway, there's what we call a shallot. It is a hollow brass tube in there that's a lot like a mouthpiece on a clarinet, and then a little brass reed on top of that. And then imagine it was a tiny mouthpiece on an instrument, you know, the player's embouchure or mouth would be over like that. On the organ pipe, this is a tuning wire, which actually goes over the reed. Get it on there. and sort of it serves almost like the player's lip on a clarinet or something, so that it places the tension in the right place for tuning. So for tuning on a reed pipe, you move this wire a little bit sometimes, and then also it has a scroll that lengthens the resonator as well. So on a reed pipe, you actually have this little vibrating beating reed in there, so that there's a moving part in it. Whereas on the flue pipes, so go back to those, there is nothing that actually moves on the pipe except for the air. So this functions like a flute, like a traverse flute, orchestral flute, or a whistle, basically a glorified whistle. So we have four, again, I'll say those again, four families of pipe organ tone: the principal or diapason, the flute, the string, and the reed. And so on the Fisk organ, let me pull some stops and give some indication. I can even compare some of these. The wooden gedeck, I don't think there's one on this organ. Some that are similar. I think this is actually a metal gedeck, but this is a... It's a similar, this is to this. Pretty much the same pipe as that. The principal, this is, I didn't blow through this one, I don't remember. Some of these have some, let's see. It's a little anemic, but principal. Not the same pitch, but anyway, principal pipe there. Quintadina, this one has that really interesting fifth sound to it. Another C. Basically that stop there. Alright. And roar flute. Is there a roar flute on this one? I think there is. Chimney flute. Flute to traverse. I think there's a chimney flute on this organ. I should know where it is. There's not. Things I should know. Anyway, the chimney flute is very much like the cadet. And then this is a little trumpet pipe, which is like the trumpet up here in the swell. So yeah, those are the and the strings. The strings, we have the viol de gamba. And the strings in an organ usually come in pairs. You have a unison string, and then you have a rank that's tuned sharp. And when they're pulled together, they form a celeste, which is imitative of, vaguely imitative of a string section in an orchestra, if not exactly. Imitative, for sure. Anyway, that's the families of the stops. To talk a little more about the Fisk organ itself, I'll move this pipe display. This instrument has three manual divisions and pedals. This organ is arranged in the manner of a French romantic organ, such that the order of the keyboards, the great or grand organ, is on the bottom. The positif or positive is in the middle, and the raci or swell is on the top. And the stop, and then of course the pedal there. And the stops are grouped. They're not really labeled per se on the console, but the pedal stops are here, the swell stops are here, the great stops there, and the positive stops there. And then the divisions in the organ we'll see as we go up, but the lowest division right above the console is the positive behind the grill cloth. And then above that, next up, is actually the grate and the pedal at what we call the impost of the organ, where the facade pipes stand. And then all the facade pipes do speak. And then way up at the very top behind the star is the swell, the raci, the very top of the organ. And so the pedal pipes are both, they're in the grate and they're also behind the organ, the main case. On the console itself, there are a lot of buttons and various things that do stuff. Most of it is related to registration aids. So all of the buttons between the keyboards are called combination pistons. And the organist can set combinations of stops that he or she wants, and when you press the button, it brings up that combination, or that is the expected result anyway. And then also, it has cool little doors that cover all the electronic gizmos in there, and these basically all are related to simply to setting combinations and crescendo, which I'll show in a second too. Nicely covered there, just what you need, so you don't have to see it all. That's what all those do. Now, down here on the bottom, of course, we have a keyboard for the feet, pedal board, which is the same sort of notes as the manual keyboards. We also have these sort of accelerator pedal things. And what these are expression pedals, or swell pedals are sometimes called. This organ has two divisions that are expressive, the swell and the positive. And these pedals are actually connected, as we'll see upstairs, to sort of Venetian blind sort of shade things upstairs. And so as you move them, there's a little inertia behind it because these are mechanical, but you can... sounds the most obvious. Close the swell down. So as you open the pedal, because on a pipe organ, the sound of the pipes never actually changes. The volume never changes. They always make the same amount of noise. But the one, if you want to control the volume, all you have to do is they have to be in a box with these shutters, and you have to close them up in the box and let it out of the way. So that's what those do. The third pedal is called a crescendo pedal, which is actually not exactly crescendo in the same way. It's, you know, the expression pedals are more like crescendo, diminuendo in playing. The crescendo pedal, per se, actually adds stops one at a time to the organ. So it's a useful registration aid if you're playing. You know, you need to add a few stops at a time. That can be set to do that. It's often used between piston changes. So if you have a piston and you're playing and you need to add just a little between piston changes, add more. But that's what that does. It actually adds stops without moving the knobs. It does it blindly, moves the stops. And the last thing down here that's sort of interesting. This organ has what's called a piston sequencer. And so if I were playing, I can certainly just say, press one, and then maybe I have something on four or six or whatever. But you can actually set sequences of pistons on this thing such that if I start with number one, and I want to go, and if I want to move through two, three, four, five, six, rather than having to go two, three, five, you can actually push these little plus buttons here. There's some down here for the feet, and there's some up here in the manual. So as you're playing, it's a real convenience. As you're playing, you can just press. So what it's doing, the same thing, it's as if it's pushing the, it's called a next or whatever, plus, it moves through sequences through the pistons, and if they're set in the right order, then it's a real convenient thing because you don't have to find the individual number, you just know where the plus is. So if you're playing a really complex piece, it's a great registrational aid. The other things out here I can demonstrate from this point of the stops, we have, we went through some of the, I showed some of the families there. There are principal stops in every division, reed stops in every division. The strings are only in the swell on this organ, but pretty much all the other families are throughout the organ. A couple of things that are a little bit interesting on the console. So we have pitch levels that are numbered, 16, 8, 4, 2 and 2 thirds, 2, etc. That go up there, and that indicates exactly, an 8-foot pitch is a unison pitch like the piano keyboard. So middle C on an 8-foot stop is going to play middle C, but on a 4-foot stop is going to play a C above, and a 2-foot stop, C above that, and likewise the 16-foot is going to play C down an octave, a tenor C. And in the pedal we have same sorts of things. We have the 8-foot is unison, would be middle C, and then we have a 4. This doesn't go above 4, but we do have a 16, and we have a 32-foot in the pedal, which up that high isn't all that profound, but down low is a sort of floor-shaking thing. And that's a real stop on this organ. It's a real set of pipes. And that's actually, it's actually a 16-foot long pipe, but it has a stopper in it. So it plays a pitch that's an octave lower. So anyway, the pitch levels are there. You'll see some on here that there are two different things that are always interesting to non-organists. They're fractional stops, and then there are stops with Roman numerals. And the fractional stops play pitches that are between the unisons. So if we have, let's say that the 8 plays C, and the 4 still plays a C, the 2 and 2 thirds is going to play a G. All right, so it plays, and it just simply adds, it changes the color of it. Right? And then on this division here, we actually still have the same thing, 2 and 2 thirds is going to be sort of the same deal. So if we have the 8, the 4, 2 and 2 thirds is a G, a tierce is going to play an E. All right, and so when you put these together, you get this. They blend together and they make a sound as a whole that's different from individuals. So you don't really hear the G's and the E's in that. And this is what's called a cornet, these five stops together. And then there's also, I didn't pull this one, it's a larigo. One and a third is an octave above a 2 2/3, so it's going to play a higher. If this plays a G on a C, this is going to play a higher G. And again, it's just all for tonal color. And what else? Let's see. The tremulant. We have a tremulant on the organ, which is going to cause a wavering effect. And so that, and on this thing, actually, it affects the entire organ. It's a general tremulant, so everything is going to. And I'll show you why in a minute. So on every division, we'll get that, and that's unusual. not on a classical organ like this, but on a lot of organs you'll have individual tremulants for each division. This organ does have a feature, though, that you can pull the tremulant only on the positive. So if you want the the cor anglais or something with the tremulant. In that case, this one will not. The other one, you know, you can play the great without it. And I'll show you how that works inside. It's kind of a nifty trick, but we'll do that. And let's see, the couplers. I didn't talk about the couplers here. So we talked about the individual divisions, but you can actually hook them together so that you can play them all at once without playing on but one keyboard. So if I have, if I have a stop on the pedal, I can do that. And I can certainly pull any number of stops on the pedal. But I can also, I pull three stops on the grate here. But if over here I find this called a coupler, it says grate to pedal. Pull that. Now I'm playing the grate, the keyboard from the pedal, and you can actually see them move a little. And likewise, if I have, let's say for instance, I'm going to put on, I'll show you two different big differences, if I put the reeds on the swell. So if I have the grate, swell to grate, get both together. And same thing, swell to pedal here. By the time you pull all of these on, you can play all of it together on one keyboard, basically, rather than have, I can pull stops all over the place, but all three keyboards, if I put all the couplers on, they'll all play together. Because this is a tracker or mechanical action organ, it actually makes it a little heavier, but I'll show you something about that inside too. But that's most everything on the console key desk, so we'll go inside and have a look at the way things are hooked up in there. So inside the base of the organ, we have several things. This is the backside of the key desk here, and it shows you very clearly the mechanical key action of the organ, which we'll see as we go on up into the instrument. But what you're seeing here actually are the backs of the keyboards, the three keyboards, 1, 2, 3. And the keys are quite long, actually. They're about 3 feet long, and they extend back into this room, into this area from there. And you can see the pedal board also has these actual extensions that come back into this room. And here you can see the back of those expression pedals and the back of the piston. So this is really right behind the console. What this basically all does, all these little series of levers and things, these are the couplers. We talked about coupling the keyboards together, how you can play one or the other. The way it works, these things sit in between these. I should back up a bit. The vertical things, which are, some of these are carbon fiber. These are actually, I think, phosphor bronze. Some of them are metal. These are carbon fiber on the ceiling. But these are what actually hook the keys to the things in the organ, the palates that actually allow the notes to play, which we'll see in a bit as we go up. But there's a tracker for each note of each keyboard in these sets. And you can see if you look above here, this is the set for the positive, and there are actually 61 of them. And they, as they go up from the keyboard all the way mechanically through little angled things all the way up. But anyway, what we're looking at here are these wooden things that go front to back, or the coupler backfalls is actually the term. And they just kind of hang out until you turn a coupler on. And on this side, you can see these big electric solenoids here. And they slide when you move the coupler on. You can hear it from the front. And it's, all it simply does is it moves a little bar in there, swings it down, and makes a fulcrum for those things to press against. And so then they couple. And it's just a simple, a fulcrum that allows it to do that. But anyway, the simple thing is that this is all the key action. If you'll look here, too, you'll notice that this is the pedal action. See, there's only 32 notes of that. It's half as many trackers. And so it comes up from the pedal board here and goes up, and these are the pedal couplers. Again, there's only halfway up the keyboard because of that. This is a good example here of a roller board. And this is an important part of a tracker organ. So the pedal keyboard, is a good 3 feet wide or more. But the keyboards and everything are much narrower. And then likewise, when we see the organ Winchest up there, it's really quite wide. It's 10, 12 feet wide. And so we have to get the mechanical linkage from the width of the keyboard or the pedal board up to the pipes that are, you know, 10 feet apart up there. And that's what the roller board does. There's this one here and there's one on the ceiling. In this case, what we're doing is condensing the motion from the width of the pedal board to the width of the manual keyboard, or half the manual keyboard. So the bottom C of the pedal board is right here, and pulls down on the C here, and there's a roller, just a little, it's an aluminum tube, basically, with pins on the end. And it pulls down this end, and then there's another arm here, which pulls on the low C there. And same thing, C sharp, it's there. And as you get further up, you can see down here, you think, well, these are pretty close to where they need to be. But when you get to top G here, it's actually right here, but it pulls way over here. So that's, you know, it moves the motion horizontally over to where it needs to be, so it lines up. Now, we'll look at the ceiling, same thing. So if this action comes right here, comes across the ceiling, this is low C of the positive, this is high C on the keyboard, 61, and they come across the ceiling right there, and there's actually an angle that you can't see at the front, then from vertical to horizontal, which is the same as these at the back, they're called squares. Anyway, the motion comes across the ceiling, should pull one here, and it pulls on, again, the end of the roller. But the problem is that this is where C on the keyboard is, but C on the Winchest is way over there on the edge. And you can see, if you look way out in the distance, you can see it move the squares, and there actually are two, there's a reason for that, those two things over there. So literally the key is hooked directly to the mechanism in the organ. And we'll see a bit more of that as we get upstairs. And that's, again, it's because this is a tracker or mechanical action organ, so the keys, between the key and the pipe, is all a mechanical linkage. So that's that bit. What we're looking at here, as we face the back of the organ, this is the wind reservoirs, the wind supply. The blower is actually two floors down in the basement, and it's quite remote. And the big metal wind trunk comes up from the blower and into this reservoir right here. And this is the cut-down reservoir. It basically sets the base wind pressure for the organ. So that's the main one. And then this one's actually for the pedal stops that are off the back of the instrument. They have their own reservoir because they take a lot more wind because they're big pipes. And then this thing up here, which looks an awful lot like a fireplace bellows because that's basically what it is the main wind reservoir. And it's different style. These are single rise, they call these, but this is a wedge bellows, so they're different shapes. This is very much what you would find in a cathedral organ in Europe in 1600. Something Bach would have played, it would have had a bellows like this. But rather than being inflated through the blower, which this is, the wind comes up through and pushes this up, which we should probably film that coming up. On those organs, they would have had a big lever, a big piece of wood, basically, attached to this end. And someone would have literally stood on the end of this thing and pulled that thing up, and then the weight would press it back down and provide the pressure. And there would have been several of these to wind the organ, because there was clearly no electricity, no blowers until the late 19th century. All organs were winded more or less that way. Some of them had what they call feeder bellows, so that you actually pumped something that put the wind into the reservoir. This is a little harder to see maybe on the camera, but on the back wall there are these plywood that look like sort of boxes, and those are actually wind trunks. So those connect, particularly, I'm trying to think which one is which, but this is the main one right here. This big wide one connects into this. So there's a hole back here, and this goes around and up. And this supplies the wind up to the manual wind chest. It all comes out of this regulator, which is actually sort of, it's not unique, but it's an interesting aspect of this organ, that the entire thing is winded off of this one reservoir. In a lot of modern instruments, you'll have every division will have one of these sort of reservoirs right under it, and so it provides a different sort of winding for the organ. We talked about the tremulant that shakes the wind. It's actually the little electric motor up on top of this thing is the tremulant. And I was going to say, if I knew where it was, I can just flip it up from back here. I think I can. Let's see. Is it this one here? Nope. It is. It's that one. There it is. So it basically is simply it's a off-center weight on a pulley and a motor, and it simply just shakes the top of this reservoir, which makes the wind shake, which makes the pipe have the tremulant sound. Anyway, that's it. So that one does the entire organ. The trick with the way you can pull it only in the positive is this organ has another stop that's here. It has flexible winding on and off. Because it has this one reservoir, there's a tendency for the wind to be flexible because it has so far to go from here way up to the rest of the organ. There's a lot of resonance in the wind trunks, and it can easily get sort of a hum, 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 and I can demonstrate that out front from you for you. But this organ has, it has what we call winkers or concussion bellows, which is what this big box is above our head. It looks like a box of plywood, but inside of this, it's really hard to see, but there's a little thin rubber sheet right there, and there's a diaphragm, basically, in a panel inside the springs that floats. And so it's a regulator, kind of like these things, in a different style. And there's two of them, and each division has these, and they're connected to the wind chest through valves that have more of those big solenoid on the, things on them, so that if you want the wind to be flexible, you can turn these things off so they're not hooked up. With that stop knob, but if you want it to be steadier, you can turn it on, and it takes out some of that sort of breathing, that feeling, sort of the wiggle to the wind. And so also what it does, if you want to only shake the wind in the positive for the tremulant, you can turn the other winkers on, and it negates the effect of the tremolo and lets it only play in the positive. So that's how it actually makes that happen, for whatever that's worth. But, that's mostly what's here. There's a little bit of electronic equipment over here. This is the, we can see the back of the stop knobs as you come by. They're over here on both sides. And that's, they have electromagnets that allow them to move in and out. But you can see that they're only hooked to the organ through wiring. There's no mechanical connection. Some tracker organs you'll have mechanical linkage to the stops also, but this one's just electric. Right here is this is the combination action memory. It's just a series of computer cards, fairly compact actually. And that's what remembers all the stops in the whole organ right there. And there are a few other little, there's some junctions and stuff behind this, but this is mainly the memory system there and power supply for the memories. And this organ has a it's called a total recall system, which is actually on the other side of the case. But you can actually save things on a flash drive, which is allows you for lots and lots of combinations. But I think that the other question that the students always ask me in here are about these gigantic silver ducks that are in here, and they are not part of the organ. And that's the interesting answer. They are part of the destratification system. So what they do is actually circulate air. We can see the top of them when we go up. Circulate air through and around the organ so that because the temperature of the organ is 30 some feet tall, and the temperature difference from here to the swell, you'll be able to feel it, is extraordinary. There can be, you know, it can be 10 degrees of difference. And so this sort of keeps it minimizes that effect because the temperature of the air is the primary thing that affects the tuning of the pipes. It has to do with the speed that the air goes through the pipes. So the more they tend to go sharp when it's warm and flat when it's cold. And so because the divisions are at different heights, the temperature makes a big difference. So that was put in when the organ was built for that reason. But it's, again, not actually part of the organ. It's just in the case. But we'll go up to the next division. I think that's most everything on the first floor. It's actually a very well thought out and safe kind of place to get into. This is an easy organ to climb into. So this is the back of the positive division, which is the, you have to always think, it is the middle keyboard on this organ. And the pipes are inside of this big box in here. And you can see the louvers on the front. I will climb in here, actually. Now I'll show you how to move the louvers for you. Not in the way of the picture. So from the console, when you move that pedal, you actually close these shutters like that. And so the pipes in here are making the same amount of sound, but they can't get out. And so then they open and close, and then there's linkages that do it all. And in this chamber, you'll notice too that the pipes they're arranged actually in what we call thirds or tierce layout. The lowest pipes are on the ends of the chamber, and then they kind of go in and they're shorter, but then there's some higher ones in the center. So we have a C side and a C sharp side, but that is further divided into a C and D and a C sharp D sharp segment. But so that's why they're sort of in a funny order. And that's a lot of what that roller board does, is it transfers the motion for the key action. But again, the big pipes are on the ends where there's more height. And in here we have, here's the roar flute. You saw the roar flute downstairs with the tube on the end. There's one of those. You can see this is actually a principal with the expression slots, but it's built somewhat like a string on the front. And the reeds are right here at the back. This is the English horn, which looks awfully like an English horn, actually. And then the crumb horn is this just a cylindrical stop there on the back. Another question the students sometimes have is the little copper plumbing pipes that are sticking up, and there's some plastic ones if you look for the back. Those have to do with resonance in the boots of the reed pipes and how they speak, and it's slightly beyond that's what they do. Now exactly how they're designed and how they work, I don't know, but it's basically a damper, almost like a plumbing thing to take up like the shock out of a water pipe, that it's related to that, to the speech of the pipes. And they're not on all of them, just on some. And we'll, can you see the key action down there? I think you can. Yeah, you can see, it's easier to see upstairs. It's kind of at eye level. Tune this, get out of it. All right. Yeah, the upstairs is really easy to see the key action. We can, as you walk right by it, we'll turn it up. Okay. And so you can see from the outside of this box, again, that it's tall on the ends and then short in the center. Yeah. Maybe this ladder down. Actually step up on top of this box. Watch your head there. There's a couple things to look at here. All right, the most interesting thing is this, and I didn't talk about this much downstairs. This is called the servo pneumatic lever. Big thing. It's basically power steering or power brakes, kind of, for the organ. More like power steering, I guess. What it does is it actually has to do with the grade and the positive on this organ. Like I said, when you couple the divisions, because you're doing twice as much mechanical work, the action gets heavier. Because you're fighting against all the... And they build the thing so that it's very little resistance. It's very efficient. But even so, there's still weight behind it. And when you're pulling the valve open in the organ, there's wind pressure against it up in the wind chest. So all these things contribute to the weight. So what this is, all these little white things are pneumatics. They're like little bellows that are used to... They actually... Because under the... This, there's wind inside of this. That it's actually pressurized. And when you have this thing on, it's not, actually the wind's not on it now because it's not on, but when it is, and you play the, and I can do that, we could demonstrate and put some of that on the film, it's a servo pneumatic lever, so it knows what you're doing, and it actually pulls on the thing. It's like, again, like power steering, it just makes it easier to move it. So you're still connected mechanically to the chest, but it's just a little extra. Takes the weight off of it, makes it a little easier when it's coupled. So when you're playing a full organ kind of thing, but that's what this does, and it's a pretty complicated mechanism. And this is actually a C.B. Fisk patent. I mean, that they own this thing. I mean, they designed it. There's something from 19th century French organs. Cavaillé-Coll built Barker levers, which were a similar thing. But in a Barker lever, there's no direct connection, and it's either off or on. So when you play the key, it goes on. This is actually, again, it moves with the key. So if you push the key part way, it only moves it part way. So it's a really clever sort of thing. But, above our heads, again, a big roller board right here. This is the roller board for the grate. So the action comes, then this narrow little space here comes up and over. You can see the little things here, the little squares and the arms, and then back around to the back of the grate chest there. And that's what we're going to see now. Let's see. And then behind us, right here, this is the action for some of the pedal pipes. So the pedal pipes are, these are the ones I think that are in the case, but there are other ones that are behind. But it's actually, this is a pneumatic chest. So there are parts of the organ, some of the biggest pipes do not play on direct mechanical action because they're located in remote places. And so what we have are these little neoprene tubes that are almost like a stethoscope tube. And they actually go up to the main wind chest. And so when you play a note on the wind chest, the wind comes out of the hole where the pipe would have been and puts pressure into another pneumatic that's in here, which then in turn opens a big valve and lets the wind through these paper tubes up to the pipes, actually. So it's a remote sort of an action for the biggest of the pipes. And we're going to go up one more, and we'll end up in the grate. And as you come up here, you can actually see the action, right? It's right at eye level inside the pallet box, and I can talk about that if you want to. Stop where you can see it. I can talk on the camera about what it is. Sort of demonstrate. If you want to stay right, yeah, kind of right there, and film into the pallet box. Sure, I can show you.
Yes.
Right there. I'll take it. This should be fine. So, again, the trackers come up here through the squares, And then there's a little pull, we call pull down wire right here. And if you look inside of the wind chest, you'll see there is a long rectangular pallet valve right up here. Good shot to get in there.
Getting that light on.
Oh, yeah. Okay, there you go. Yeah. And the pallet valves run, they're front to back, and they're long rectangular things. And when you pull on this, it actually just opens the valve. And this is hooked to the keyboard downstairs. So that's what you're doing when you play the note downstairs. Now, to get a little more explanation of what we're seeing here, so we have, the pallet valve is a long rectangular piece of wood, and it's hinged on one end, basically, and it has a leather gasket on it. The way the chest works, and I didn't talk about this downstairs, this organ has what's called slider chest or slider pallet chests, and you have to think in terms of math, like an XY grid. And what we have are the, and I don't remember which one is which, but we'll say X is front to back. The X would be the note channel. So all of these notes right here are actually G-sharps, it's labeled. So every note front to back is a G-sharp. And they're all on one channel, which is basically just a space between two boards that are inside the wind chest, in this space here above those pallet valves. And if we go left to right, or the y-axis, we have a stop. So notes are front to back. All the C's are in a row this way, but all the clarions, actually, in this case, are in a row this way, and all the trumpets. So that's the arrangement there. And so when we pull the pallet down, we're sending wind to all of those G-sharps, every one of them. Now, nothing's playing right now because we don't have stop on. But all of the G-sharps have wind if we do that. Now, how do we make the stop play? That's where the slider part comes in. This is the pallet part of the slider pallet. The slider is actually goes under the entire stop. And in this organ, they're made out of clear plastic, and you can see just the very end of it there. But it's a long, thin, this one's about an inch and a half wide, that goes all the way under every pipe. And it has, there's a hole, obviously, that's drilled up above the pallet, and then there's a hole under this pipe. And this piece of plastic also has holes in it that will line up with the other holes. But the way it is right now, it's off, they're not lined up, so they're shifted over. And so when you move this over, when that slides over, the holes line up and it plays, slides back the other way, doesn't play. All right, and each stop is like that. Well, that's a different thing. And here's another one. All right, so anyway, that's the... And they're attached across, too. You can see this way, too. So as I mentioned in the positive, the chests are divided into C and C-sharp sides for several reasons. It helps with tuning, because there's the acoustic, the physics of the notes playing against one another. And it also helps with weight, so it spreads the weight out. Because if you had all the big pipes on that side and all the little ones, and some organs are built that way, and it can be done, but this spreads the weight all over the whole thing, because they're quite heavy. They're lead, tin. What else did I say? So again, the sliders, there's a motor right here. It's the same ones we saw downstairs that run the couplers. And to each end of it is hooked to a side of the slider. And so when it's on, it moves the entire thing left and right, C and C-sharp sides. And so the benefit of these things, there's several. I mean, there are any number of ways of building pipe organs and actions. And the organ of McAllister Auditorium is what's called an electropneumatic action, uses electric magnets and then little pneumatic pouches to play the notes. And there are ones that use various other types of things. But this mechanical organ, one of the real benefits to it is that there's very little to wear out or fail in it. The linkages do wear, but it takes a long time. This is something that will last 100 plus years without any real major work on it. The other thing about the stop action here, when we're considering the organ like the McAllister organ, it has a moving part under every pipe, basically, a pouch. This only has one moving part per note, the pallet, and then plus each stop has one moving part, the slider. So we're talking two moving parts instead of 61 per every stop, And that's one of the benefits. And there's nothing wrong with the other way of doing it, but it's just there's benefits to both. It depends on what you're after with it. But this is certainly a very efficient way of doing it. And this is the way organs were built from the very beginning. The earliest organs were probably built in 1200, I would say, and then in their modern form. That was the beginnings of the modern organ. And then they were built with this type of action up until 1890. So it was, we're talking hundreds and hundreds of years of you know, 500 years of building organs just like this. And there's been a return in the late, mid-20th century, and certainly 21st century, particularly with fine organs like this, of using mechanical action because of the longevity and the, you know, the tradition and just the artistic expression that's possible with a mechanical instrument like this. You're so intimately connected to the sound producing parts of the organ, which is, you know, is a part of a problem with an organ. You know, when you're playing, even if you're playing a piano, you're very intimately connected to that. But certainly with a woodwind or a string instrument, organs seem to be very cold and distant. But the mechanical action really sort of takes it back towards being a much more personal sort of thing. But so there's a real preference for that amongst some organists. So what else is up here? So this is the great chest, and the great is the primary division. You'll notice that this is not enclosed. You see, this is the back of the facade. There are no shades. There's no box. All right, so we're just out in the room. These pipes you can't actually control the volume of. You can turn the stops off and on, but there's no control of the volume. Looking at the actual chest, there's principal pipes up front. This is a flute. This is interesting if you can get this on the camera. This is the harmonic flute, which I didn't play from downstairs, but it has this little tiny hole halfway up. You'll see everyone has one. And the pipe is actually twice as long as it needs to be. And it has a little hole at the sort of the node of where the wave would be, so that it only allows it to play as if it were this long, but it has the resonance of the pipe at this long. So it has a really beautiful, singing, clear sound. Almost sounds like a flute, like a real flute, orchestral flute. And it's called a harmonic flute. And there's some little things here. I don't know what they are. This is actually a spill flute, and you'll notice it's tapered, which is a different style of pipe. And then, like I said, the reeds are on the back, and we heard those a minute ago, the trumpet and the clairon. And then you can see, and these reeds look a little different than the one downstairs, but you can still see the boot and the wire and the resonator. It's basically the same parts there. On the back of this, in this chamber, are the pedal chests. And you'll see, you know, we talked about how it's only got 32 notes, and so there's 16 on each side. And whereas, you know, this chest goes all the way from the wall and keeps going to the middle with these little pipes, you can see that one only, it's much shorter and bigger pipes there. And then on the back, some more of the wooden flutes, kind of like that little one we saw that's part of those. This is all pedal. And so in the middle is this big chest, which actually contains power supplies that run those big stop magnets. So I'm going to close the door here. And there's one more ladder and one more level. And you can see the tracker runs that come up the front, and this is actually the action for the racer, the swell. And this is the top, this is the end of it right here. And so this, and I will show you from underneath, this is a minor thing, but the swell chests, whereas all these other chests were left and right, the swell chests are turned 90 degrees, so they actually run front to back, and there are two of them. And there's this space in between is actually something you can stand upstairs, and so the action runs from side to the sides rather than all the way over. That's why I see there's no action over here, and you'll see that upstairs. As you climb up here, this is the trickiest climb. It's not too bad to watch the pipes on the way up. What you have to do, I'll show you, is come up here, watch your head, and then it's like a treehouse. You have to step back and over that. Do you want me to take you out the camera?
Yeah.
Do you want me to see?
That's what you're talking about. A little more interesting to have it while you're coming.
Yeah. All right, so up here, this is where some of the students finally say, you know, enough.
I want to keep going to heaven here.
This is it. This is the top, so almost the top. So here we have the top of those stratification ducts, and you can actually feel the air coming out of that. And this one may be the intake one here. I can't remember. Yeah, I think it is. They come in and they do it now. And it actually has a chiller on it, too, that cools the air. But so from up here, we can see this is... I should go down and play this for you. I probably should do that while you're standing here. This is the bottom C of the posaun, or the trombone. And this pipe is, you know, it's this big around. It's actually bent around like a trombone or a trumpet downstairs. It's mitered. So this would actually be a 16-foot-long pipe if it's all the way up. And it's a pretty profound sound that thing makes. If you look, and I'll go ahead and play it. If you look at the back, this is actually behind the main case, these wooden pipes here. This is there are two things back there. This is the 32-foot subas, which is the floor shaker thing. And then also there's a 16-foot, what it is, principal. No, it's an 8-foot principal. Anyway, there's more wooden pipes. I think it's a Borden or something. But this is the biggest of the pedal pipes are back there behind the main case, and they play off on that separate action. I'm gonna step down here and make this pussy on play just so you put that on tape because it's pretty. It's loud downstairs, but it's quite something up here. It's not painful. It's just big.
Oh no, I like rock music. Don't worry. When people say the organ is cold, they're missing the point.
Yeah.
Because it's not.
Sure. No. So, let's see. There's big pedal pipes back there. And if you look out the front, you can see we're basically at the top of the organ. Ah. And this is, you can either go under this or squeeze through it there. So this is about 3 feet up.
You can't be a big person and come up here.
No, or you have to climb under, yeah.
Yeah.
This right here, this is the front of the racee, or the swell, and you'll notice that it has the shutters also on the front with you that move the same way. And where we are, this pipe right here in the center, there's a little nut right there, and that is the star that's on the front of the organ. So, and this is the very top. This is the top of the front of the case right there. But, it's very safe because there's nowhere to go. I'll open this door. This is inside of the swell. Let me show you that. That. And it looks in some ways a lot like the other divisions, but the difference, as I said, you'll see there's two chests that are left and right. And the we have in here we've got a lot of different things that we talked about downstairs. There of course reeds back here, two reeds, a 16 and a 4 that are back there. Here's the string here, you can see the expression slots in the string and how thin the pipes are. They're very, very thin for their length. And then we have a roar flute, another roar flute with little chimneys on it there. And what else do we have here? We have a mixture. We didn't talk much about these. So the mixture, I don't think I mentioned those downstairs. The ones with the Roman numerals are basically every note has 4, 5, or 6 or whatever pipes. And so the Roman numeral indicates how many pipes there are per note. And the pipes play various harmonics. They're going to play a fifth or a unison generally, but at various octave levels. And so each of these, this is a 3-rank or 4-rank mixture. Partway, it changes as you get up in the scale, in the register. But they're in groups in little families of 4, and that's per each note, and that's sort of unique to a tracker organ. Let's see that the trumpet, and then this is the oboe, which has the slightly belled in top on it. And let's see, and then again, here we have a 16-foot Borden that's at the back, and you'll notice again it's got the tubed off actions because it stands off the back of the instrument of the chamber. And yeah, that's mostly what's there. And then the zimbal stern, the bells, the little bells actually are on top of the swell box up on the very top. And I've actually been up there. That's the highest up I've been. And I can show you how you get up there. You have to climb up and hold on to the ceiling steel rafters to climb up there. It was scary. And then once I got up, I thought, well, this is okay. But yeah. So and then the other thing I can show you on this one, this chamber had this so you can see there's shutters that are all on 3 sides. And it was designed that way originally because it lets the most sound out, in and out, usually the most expression. What they found when it was done, just because something they didn't anticipate, was how loud the swell division is. And so they made the decision to do a couple things. They closed off these shutters so that they don't open. Only the ones in the very back open. There's about 3 or 4 on each side that do open for the bass sort of pipes there. But most of the side, these are actually, they're shut permanently. We open them to tune, basically. And so only the front opens, and they've also put, if you look up, you see there's a blanket above there that actually absorbs a bit of a sound, and it's just, again, because it was just so, it didn't balance right, it did not do quite what they had expected, they were surprised, so they made some changes on site to that, but it made it work out. So, yeah, so that's mostly the organ, at least this part. There was something I was going to show you downstairs, too, something, I don't remember what it was, but that's most of it. That part of it. So you can see out here that they, this is always kind of funny, this is the
little shame. Here's a little bit of
This
was the linkage that controlled the side shades on the organ, and so they just
but you don't use them.
So they detached it, and this was just and it was just left, and so it could be put back. I mean, it's still there, but it's a little that's a little funny.
But it sounds like it was necessary.
I think but you can see these out here. That's these couple little shades here that actually do open.
In the back. That's right.
You said that move. Yeah. And like I said, the bells are the little semicircle is way up there on the top of that. So you have to actually you climb up here, and then you step up on here, and then you have to hold on to that steel beam there and step over the top of the toolbox. And that's exciting. Yeah. I've only done it once. Well, twice. I had to go and figure out what was wrong with it and then go back to actually fix it.
Oh, God.
Just watch these trumpets on the way down because they're right next to you. But they're not terribly fragile. But
wanted some of these down shots. I thought maybe kind of a perspective.
I didn't mention this. That sort of angled tube there. That's the trundle or the thing that makes the swell shades move. So it has arms on it too to the top and bottom. So when you move the shoe down there, you actually is turning that vertical column, and then upstairs it transfers that motion.
Have you ever been in here when someone was playing it?
Yes, or
are you doing this?
It's going to be fairly definite. I was going to say, if you want to stay up here, I'll play a little of the great.
I'd be curious to get that on. Yeah.
Put that on the tape for sure, because you can hear some of the sound. And it's very different inside. I'm used to being in the organ just for, and you can hear a little bit when I did that. But from a tuning standpoint, we usually just do one note at a time. But it's interesting because I won't play it incredibly loud, but you can actually feel. You don't want to touch the pipes because they've got a tune, but you can actually feel the wind.
In this area?
Yeah, if you're
in a good area.
This is a good spot. And okay. I'll pop down and play a little on the grate, and then you can. I tell you what. Well, after that, we can come down a level on top of this, and I'll turn on the pneumatic lever. So you can
okay.
See that,
yes.
See that if I can make it do the right thing.
Yeah, I felt that one. All right. Thank you.
thing you'll see goes down is the cut down reservoir down there. It's going to go first. As it starts to fall, then the blowers quit making wind, and then you'll notice the others begin to fall, and the pedal one will go, and then this whole wedge will start to fall. And right now, you could actually, if the stops were on, you could still play the organ, because there's still wind in it. Oh. The stops won't be on, because the electricity's off, but on a mechanical organ, you could still play it. And, you know, if you left the stop on, you could still play it here. I could even demonstrate that, probably, if it's off. So anyway, then it goes down, and it's still falling out. Finally, it all goes.
And then that is moving when you're using it? Or yeah, when they are going through it?
And I'll show you that. Yeah, okay. Exactly. So we've seen it sitting still because we're doing anything.
Right.
But when I'm playing it, you'll see it. So it's basically that's basically out. There's basically no wind in it now.
So that's you just taking the power away from it?
Yeah, turn the blower off. So the power's turned off. So the fan downstairs, it's, you know, the blower downstairs, it's not as big as you'd think. It's, you know, it's... 3 feet. Oh. So it's, you know, it looks like is those leaf blowers they use on campus. It's like those big round those things.
Okay,
it's got an electric motor.
Yeah.
It's much quieter, but it's in a loud room down there. But the blower itself is pretty quiet. Anyway, it's off now. So the blower is off. Plus the DC that runs all the stop actions is off.
Mm-hmm.
So when I kick it on, you'll immediately it comes up pretty quickly. You'll see them just go shoop, and then this will inflate and be right up. Really quickly. Yeah.
Yeah.
It's filled up. So let me show you. Wow. I'm going to do two things. I'll play some big chords so you can watch it react.
Mm-hmm.
And then I'll show you the flexible wind thing. Which
all right.
You can, it's more of an aural thing. You can hear it more than. Draw of the wind. So when it draws the wind away, it doesn't, because these little compensator winker concussion bells are not on, they're not working intentionally, then it allows it, the resonance and that, you know, the wind, when it sucks the wind away, it reacts and there's nothing to take that away. And so it gives it the idea is that that's the way the organs, that early organs sounded, because they didn't have all this steady wind. Mm-hmm. That's a 19th, 20th century phenomenon to have steady wind like that. So it allows you to play, if you choose on this instrument, to play earlier music with that sort of a reactive wind, like that live wind.
Yeah.
And so, and it's, you know, and the way I have it registered is probably not very authentic, but it certainly shows the point.
Yes.
You can see it reacting for sure.
Oh, this is fascinating.
Yeah, but again, and that flexible wind off gives it just some life to it. Again, it allows the organ to kind of breathe like a, you know, like a choir, a singer breathing together, and it's just, again, just a different sound.
Yeah, because that's what I've always heard with the organ, where like choirs or voices, when it's played right in the right literature, and all of a sudden it's like this mysterious voice.
And this organ has, you know, the two things about it that make it interesting to me, and that you've mentioned, the temperament being slightly unequal gives it sort of a real interesting sort of a color to it.
Yeah.
But also that the wind, even with the wind stabilizers on, so that the flexible wind's off, it still reacts when you're playing, and it has almost, you know, really, you get this, you know, kind of a real attack to the voicing of it that I think is really exciting, particularly when, you know, for big music, where, you know, it's not just on, you know,
yeah,
it's you can feel it.
That, you know, that's what
I felt. It's very alive.
When Charles let me play it a little.
The temperament, and I can't remember exactly where the intervals are different on this, but particularly, the, you know, the key of C, is compared to normal equal temperament, it's a very slow beat.
Yeah.
A normal third is.
Oh my God! Well, it's 14 cents away. Yeah.
You can actually hear the third beating. The quite pure, but no, that C F fifth is actually very pure.
Wow.
And see how you said that third is really slow. That's an extremely flat third. But so the F major has just a beautiful, just
yeah.
You know, whereas if you play in D flat major,
okay, yeah, all of a sudden
that's very, you know, angry sounding.
Yeah.
Yeah, angry,
it's
just edgy.
Yeah, yeah,
it
has a lot to, yeah.
B major's not as bad. B major's, I mean, it's the flat keys that are the angriest. But they're all quite playable. It's just that, but it, you definitely hear the, you know, flavors of the different keys.
Yeah, yeah, and I mean, that's what I like about this, or the Whale Temperament or the circular ones, is that each key has its own flavor, you know?
And have you looked at the odd organ?